Welcome back to the MOOC course titled Qualitative Research Methods. My name is Aradhana Malik. I'm helping you with this course. And we have been talking about various things related to various aspects of qualitative research. We have talked about what qualitative research is, what qualitative researchers do. And now we are moving into a module called the dominant paradigms in qualitative research. We will discuss a few of the dominant paradigms, but in order to discuss the paradigms of specifically pertaining to qualitative research, we must know the background behind those paradigms. We must understand what a paradigm is and how different paradigms evolved and which ones are most applicable to qualitative research, which ones are most applicable to the kind of research that we are talking about here. Okay. So what is a paradigm? A paradigm is a set of beliefs that a researcher uses to guide the research process. It's a worldview, it is a mindset, it is where you're coming from. Okay, it is who you are, what do you think, how are you approaching the problem. That is a paradigm, the mindset that we use in order to arrive at a problem. And this worldview is rooted in the researcher's training in the research process. So how you were trained, what you were trained to believe, what you were trained to use, how you studied this whole process of research per se, and what you were taught to believe as truth, what you were taught to believe as knowledge base, what you were taught to believe as meaning, reality, addition to the knowledge base, or the creation of new knowledge. So all of this adds to our understanding of what research is and how it should be conducted. All of us have different ways of looking at things. Also, we must understand that our training in how to approach different problems also affects how we work on them. So some people may say that human behavior can be quantified and should be quantified because we want to make predictions, because we want to make profits. One example of this is business research methods, which is a very, very important aspect of managerial training. Unless we know what our customers want, how can we give it to them? So the whole area of marketing uses this extensively. We try to predict consumer behavior, for example, is rooted in the predictions of human behavior as far as their propensity to buy products and services is concerned. So, you know, and that is a result of quantification to quite an extent. What has the pattern been and how is the pattern going to be? How does the history of the pattern of purchase of certain items predict whether people will buy the same thing in future or not, or similar things in future or not? So how a person approaches the problem, what a person feels can feed into that problem is an important aspect of what techniques a person uses, and that is in turn a result of what the person was trained in or how the person was trained to approach different problems. The other thing that affects how researchers view research is the researcher's experiences with the context in which the research process is going to take place. How familiar are you with the context? So if I am a pure academic, I have never visited a village, and I'm saying this with reference to the course I just taught on the MOOC platform just before this. It's quite possible that some of you may have enrolled for that course. The course was on titled Strategic Communication for Sustainable Development. So I'm taking the example from there. If I'm a pure academic who has never visited the village, my view or my way of approaching problems, thinking about problems, my perception of the problems in rural areas will be based on secondary data. Very truthful, very believable secondary data, UNICEF reports, World Bank reports, this, that. But then my worldview will be based on what I read about it, or maybe even YouTube videos, as opposed to my being a part of that context. How familiar am I with that context? Do I even know how to get information out of people. I may have excelled in the art of interviewing, I may have scored very high marks or maybe full marks in a paper on interviewing and research methods, but till I go and speak to the people in their language and understand what lies behind getting that information, I mean, I won't say I stand nowhere, I stand on a different level than people who don't have all these degrees and professional qualifications, but know how to get information out of people. So, you know, our familiarity drives the paradigm we use for research to quite an extent. Then, the researcher's personal belief system about the research process, why, how, etc. Now, I personally believe that it is very important to use a mixed methods research process for studying human behavior. A mixed methods design is much more important to study human behavior than a purely quantitative or a purely qualitative research design, for the simple reason that there are some aspects of human behavior that can be categorized and quantified, and there are other aspects of human behavior that cannot be categorized. I personally am a person who will react to the question, oh, I can predict your behavior with, okay, right, I'll tell you. So, you want to predict my behavior? All right, I'm going to prove you wrong. So, you know, I'm talking at the very micro level, and people will start laughing, and then, you know, people will say that that is not how the world works, but that is very true. Human behavior can be very unpredictable at times, and I like to look between the lines and see where it is unpredictable and how unpredictable it is, what is the extent of this lack of predictability and how predictable it is. So, you know, the mixed methods research design or the mixed methods approach works best for people like me, because I have studied various things. My background, my belief system, my understanding of human behavior may be the same as many of you and may be very different from others. And that is precisely what drives the research design I use in my own research in approaching problems where I have to study human behavior. So, you know, I mean, these are very, very, very basic things that help us shape our worldview. What is knowledge? How do we perceive knowledge, etc.? So, these worldviews are rooted in what we know about the research process, our background, our biases, our training, our opinions, our urge to go deeper into the case, etc. Okay, the cornerstones of a paradigm. What are the cornerstones? The pillars on which this whole notion of a paradigm stands are, the first one is ethics or axiology. How will I be as a moral person in the world? This is what it attempts to answer. This is again from this book by Denzin and Lincoln, the book that I've been telling you about, Handbook of Qualitative Research Methods, edited by Denzin and Lincoln. And I have this book, I have a copy of this book. I'll just show you the cover. So please focus on the book. Thank you. So this is the book I'm using. This is the 2000 edition. And I also have a copy of the 1994 edition, but it's not possible to show that here. Anyway, so this is from this book, and so the whole principle or the pillar of axiology deals with how will I be as a moral person in the world? How do I treat the research process? What is the cornerstone? What is my anchor when I'm doing research? Where do I stop? What do I explore? What is sensitive information? What is not sensitive information? Or what is an area that I would like to explore? Where do I draw the line between getting information out of subjects and using them for my research? So, you know, there's a very fine line between getting help from someone and using someone. So, you know, all those things. So, how do I approach this from a researcher's standpoint, who needs information and data and who needs to get things done, and how much of manipulation I use in the research process? We need to sometimes manipulate the situation. Intrusive research, for example, medical research is very, it's invasive. Psychological research can be very intrusive. You actually break through the barriers of a person's mind, enter in, get valuable data out, and then many times one forgets to seal whatever one has broken open. So, axiology, where does one draw the line? Then epistemology, how do I know the world? What is the relationship between the knower and the known? How do I understand what knowledge is, or what I am exploring? What is my relationship as an inquirer with the inquired? Okay, then ontology, what is the nature of reality and the nature of the human being in the world? How do I perceive reality? That is ontology. Methodology, study of methods. What are the methods available to me, and what is the best method for me to use, or I won't even use the word best, most appropriate method that I can use to approach a particular problem. Okay, so these are the four pillars or cornerstones of the paradigms we use in our research. Okay, so some dominant paradigms. The first one that we are going to talk about is positivism. I'll just read. Positivism is a term coined by Auguste Comte, I hope I'm pronouncing the word right, indicating a philosophy of strict empiricism. The only genuine or legitimate knowledge claims are those that are founded directly on experience. Comte sought to advance the project of positive knowledge by distinguishing this kind of dependable empirical knowledge from claims made by theology and metaphysics, and we will dwell a little bit more on this. So, positivism is exploring real situations that can be verified, that can be tested. Exploration of real situations, building knowledge on our understanding of real systems. The characteristics of positivism are, as far as the ontology is concerned, naive realism, which says that our senses are our primary windows to the world, actually our only windows to the world. And what we perceive from our senses is the real world. So, we perceive directly from our senses, and that can be verified. Anyone with the same senses will perceive the same things that anyone else does. That is the ontology. Epistemology, the findings we are dealing with are true because they are rooted in empirical inquiry. Anyone can go and check them. So, whatever we are saying is rooted in empirical inquiry. We are inquiring about what we see, what we experience through our senses, and we are using empirical methods. Anyone with the same set of resources will arrive at the same conclusion, and that is how we know. We test what we see. Methodology is experimentation, validation, verification, and quantitative methods. The aim methodology is experimentation, validation, and verification, and all this is done through quantitative methods. The aim of inquiry is primarily explanation, prediction, and control. Explanation, why is something like that? Why not something else? So, we talk about, it is not even why not, it is explaining, it is describing things by way of testing them, by way of going deeper into what we see. Then prediction, based on what we see happening, we see patterns and we predict on the basis of that, and we control certain variables to see how other things are, the dependent variables are affected by controlling certain situations or the independent variables. Okay, the aim of inquiry is this. Now, how do we know that this research is good? How do we know that it is of good quality? The criteria we use are conventional benchmarks of rigor. It is thorough, it is systematic, it is rigorous, and internal and external validity. Now, validity means that the set of methods used answers the question that was asked. So, the connection between the methods, the output in relation to the methods is answering the question that was asked. Reliability is whether this method repeatedly gives us the same or similar response. Okay, so validity is the fit between the question and the answer, and reliability is the repetitive or the repeated response that we get, or the same getting similarity of responses. I'm sorry, reliability is the similarity in the responses we get by use of the same method. And objectivity, our personal biases are not coming in, etc. And the type of narration, what do we get at the end of it? It is scientific report. Okay. That is positivism. It is very similar to, it's not the same as empiricism, but we will not even touch empiricism because it's not connected even loosely to what we are going to talk about later. Okay. Post-positivism, on the other hand, is that, you know, researchers started realizing that maybe there is something above and beyond what we can test, what we can verify, what we can validate. So, after the period of positivism came a period of post-positivism, where researchers said, okay, fine, maybe there are things that will not be experienced by our senses, but they will still be there. Maybe there are things that cannot be verified. Maybe there are things that can be verified. Maybe there is a gray area. And that is what post-positivists said. So, they argue that the best we can do is to develop contingent, fallible knowledge claims. We can develop claims, but we must realize that they are contingent, which means they are only answering the question that has been asked at a specific point in time. And fallible, they are open to, or they are subject to people questioning them, revising them, or even throwing them out. Okay, it's not the absolute truth. Now, characteristics of post-positivism, the first one is ontology. So, how do we know? Critical realism. So, this is, what is the nature of reality is real reality, but only imperfectly and probabilistically apprehendable. Critical realism. What is there, may be there, may not be there. It may not have the same size and shape that we think it has. It may not have the same features that we think that it has. So, we are open to additions, deletions, modifications to our notions of reality. Then, epistemology. What we have found may or may not be true. We are trying our best to find the most appropriate truth or the most appropriate knowledge here, but we are open to accepting that whatever we have found may be true, it may not be true. Everything cannot be verified. What we have decided, but we will go with the hope that whatever we have discovered is very likely to be true, because we have we have put in the rigor that is required, we have used standard methods, but we are open to accepting that this may or may not be true. Methodology is modified experimental. It may include qualitative methods. So, it is not only experimental, there is some element of this gray areas there. The aim of inquiry is again the same as positivism, primarily explanation, prediction and control. Goodness or quality criteria also remain the same as positivism, which is conventional benchmarks of rigor, internal and external validity, reliability and objectivity, and the type of narration or what we get in the end is a scientific report. Okay. The next one is constructivism, and we will talk about it in much greater detail later on. We have a special lecture devoted to it, so or a series of lectures devoted to it. So, I will not go very deep into it. It is a philosophical perspective interested in ways in which human beings individually and collectively interpret or construct the social and psychological world in specific linguistic, social and historical contexts. The constructivist paradigm assumes a relativist ontology, which means there are multiple realities. A subjectivist epistemology, which means the knower and respondent co-create understandings, and a naturalistic set of methodological procedures. So, this paradigm assumes that there can be more than one reality. What we think is real for us, it may be different for somebody else. A subjectivist epistemology, which means the relationship between the knower and known, is what creates this reality. Okay, we know the world through the co-creation of what the knower and the known believe together to be real. And the methods that are used, or the methodological procedures, study of methods is rooted in the natural world. We will talk much more about it in the upcoming lecture, so I will not dwell too much on it. Okay, characteristics, ontology is relativism. How do we know that it's real? Local and specific constructed realities. So there are local realities and there are constructed realities, and everything is relative. Epistemology is transaction or subjective created findings. We create reality. How do we know that something is real? By creating it together in and through communication. We talk about it. Do you think this is so? No, I think this is something else. Okay, fine. So we negotiate, we talk about it, and we come to a mutual understanding of what reality is. The aim of inquiry, sorry, methodology is hermeneutic or dialectic, which means we try to understand about the situation that we are in and through dialogue, and we construct the links between the different pieces of information that we get in order to perceive a combined collective whole. So aim of inquiry is understanding. What do we hope to achieve through this method or through this paradigm? Our ultimate goal is to understand or to reconstruct the commonly held understanding. So we want to know more. I want to know it. I want to know it from a different perspective. I want to explore. Goodness or quality criteria, how do we know that the work is good or of good quality? Trustworthiness and authenticity, because everything is rooted in the co-construction of reality. So the people involved need to get together and decide whether it's authentic. And trustworthiness. Narration is interpretive case studies. So that is the ultimate output. Okay. The last paradigm that we are going to talk about very briefly over here is critical theory, and we will have another set of lectures on this later on. Critical theory focuses on in-depth and thorough understanding of the connection between assumptions, description, and explanations, and challenges current beliefs in doing so. Critical theory says that I'm not satisfied with whatever there is. Something is wrong. Something is wrong somewhere. And this came out of the Marxist philosophy that primarily tried to explore why or how, you know, this whole system of injustice percolated into the society. Somebody had more, somebody had less. And the Frankfurt School actually dealt with or started the discussion, or was one of the groups that started the discussion on on critical theory. The links are provided here. We don't have time, but actual videos of an interview with Professor Herbert Marcuse are available through this link. So you know, you can actually, you know, once you get the slides, you can watch this yourself. But critical theory just tries to challenge current beliefs about certain things and asks, why is something like this? Why not like this? So we uncover the layers. It is there. We know it's there, but we are not fully satisfied with the explanation that is there. Okay. Characteristics, again, very, very briefly. Characteristics, historical realism. Ontology is historical realism. So the reality that we perceive is rooted in history. And history means social, political, cultural, economic, ethnic, and gender values crystallized over time. How do we know what is historical? It's a collection of the way reality has been perceived over time. Epistemology is transactional, subjectivist, and value-mediated findings. What do we believe to be true in and through our conversations, communication, and in light of our belief systems. What should be true, what should not be true. Methodology is again dialogic or dialectic, in and through communication. Aim of inquiry is not to uncover anything, it is critique and transformation. So we believe, we start with the assumption that whatever is there is not enough. We are not saying it's not true, it's just not enough. There is something missing, there's something has to be added. So it is critique and transformation through the critique, restitution and emancipation. Goodness or quality criteria. So our goal is to find out what is not right, find out why it's not right, and take steps to fix it. That is the aim of critical, of inquiry using the critical theory paradigm. Goodness or quality criteria are historical situatedness, erosion of ignorance and misapprehension. So we prove that something is not right because X situation was not looked at, and ultimately the provision of a stimulus for action. And we will deal with it in greater detail when we discuss critical theory. So we are looking at the provision of a stimulus for corrective action. Yes, first we uncover what is not right and why it's not right, and then say, okay, now that we have done it, something needs to be done about it. So the stimulus is provided just by virtue of unraveling something that was closed earlier. It is there, but it's not fully clear as to what is underneath the surface. Narration is the what do we get? The output is historical, economic, socio-cultural analysis. So these are the characteristics of critical theory, and these are the paradigms that we will be covering in the course of the next few lectures. This is all we have time for today. Thank you very much for listening.